Show. The Big Show. The Big Show.
Welcome back to The Big Show. Today we're bringing you more enticing stories about how students at Rutgers are using their creativity and ingenuity in unexpected ways. Today's episode revolves around harnessing technology to make things move. Our correspondent Claudine sat down with the Rutgers Solar Car Team. The Solar Car Team is a club striving to promote solar innovation. They discuss interesting ideas about the future of solar power, as well as their upcoming plans to race their vehicle. Then we'll jet off to meet the Rocket Propulsion Lab, where we will see a rocket made from scratch take flight into new and exciting territories. Join us as we take a look behind the curtain at the incredible ways these students are using their talents and be propelled into a world of knowledge and inventiveness.
So my name is Ariana Ursula. I'm the captain for the Rocket Propulsion Lab. I've been captain for about 2 years now, and it's been quite an experience for sure. Right when I had started my job at the Rutgers Makerspace, I had also just accepted the role as captain. And when I was talking to my boss, I was like, how do I make this work? Like, how could I possibly make this team of Rocketeers, like, you know, continue this drive to all the way up to space? How do I do it? And my boss said to me, well, there's something you need to keep in mind. And what you need to keep in mind is that there are certain places that should be treated as a business, and there are certain places that have to be treated like a community. And he said, in the case of the Makerspace and in the case of RRPl, RRPl is a place that needs to be treated like a community.
You know, we train our members with hands-on experience so they learn what they're not learning in their classrooms.
When you get to RRPl, you get to build, and it's fun. Or you get to take the things that you do and you get to actually figure things out and how to put things together.
Because, like, I've been able to make friends with, like, so many people with so many different experiences. So being able to gain insight from them has been so great. Just, like, having a group of people there who just love what they're doing.
We usually just kind of sit down and figure out, you know, like, what our goals for the launch are. And in this case, this was just the top half of our spaceport rocket, which is a competition later in the year. So we wanted to test a couple different systems. And then, you know, we come up with a design like this, and we do an assembly procedure, which basically takes everything from, like, the pages and our CAD models and puts it onto a way for our members to easily assemble it.
So this was our first launch at MDRA, and when we went there, we didn't expect such creativity. I think MDRA is the most creative field we've ever seen. Such creativity in the flights, because we're so focused on doing our two-stage, but there's also a lot of different ways to be creative, and seeing that was actually pretty inspiring.
But then, yeah, once we're there, we assemble the different components, and generally just it works out so we're like the people who worked on those components get to assemble them and put them into the rocket.
But all the work is like internal, all the electronics and the brains of it. But it's really cool because suddenly it's there. And you're like, I've seen this on my computer and I recognize these parts, but now this connects to this and this connects to this, and you know, my parts are suddenly on the inside and I can't see them, and they're probably tied to the parachutes by now and stuff like that. So it's crazy because everything suddenly looks so simple. Seeing the rocket go up after all that time, actually on the launch pad, it always feels so surreal. I'm always scared I'm gonna blink and miss it go up.
Yeah, it's always, there's nothing that's comparable to seeing something that you've built fly into the sky, for sure.
It was, I was like watching it happen, but I wasn't like watching it happen. I was like, oh God, how long am I gonna have to hold this antenna up? Because I was holding a computer in one arm and an antenna in the other, and I was just like lifting it up, trying to track the rocket using one of the boards, and I was like, oh God, I hope I can still see it, oh God.
Okay, it took off. Is it gonna come down correctly? So we're looking and we're like, who has eyes on it? Who has the chute? Who sees a parachute? Who has a separation event? And we're all standing there, we're all like holding our breath, and we watch it, and we were standing there like looking at the sky, and we're all losing track of it, and it's bright and sunny, and we're staring right at it.
When you go to the launch, you see the human aspect of everyone being so excited that it's on the pad, but then you also see the sheer power of it, and the way it just flies, and you know, everyone is looking at the sky, pointing at it, trying to find it, and it's definitely an experience like no other, for sure. We need to make sure that our younger members carry the same passion and community, and also the same technical ability. So when we went up and launched that rocket, you might notice that all of those people up there touching it were all younger members, and someday they'll be able to use that and be able to guide the next generation.
And as soon as we got there, when we had the rocket up on the stand and I was up on that ladder like arming boards, I was like, whoa, this is real. I'm officially gonna go launch a rocket.
It shows that it's time for us to move on and it's time for us to pass down everything, but it also goes to show that we're facilitating the growth of a new generation, for sure. So,
yeah, the people are great. I mean, like, they're all hilarious, and we all like hang out outside of the club too. So like, not only that, but they're also like really smart, and it's kind of humbling.
Like, I've made long-lasting friendships from the members of RRPl, meeting fantastic people like the other people that you interviewed, Ariana.
Having Ariana there, she's been kind of like a beacon to most of the underclassmen because she's like the face of a lot of the stuff that we do. Even after Ariana graduates, after all of our team leads go, I want to be able to maintain that people will come, will be able to learn, and then they'll be able to do all the stuff they need to do so that way our team can continue like flourishing.
But I think my big moment that I will remember is actually just the day-to-day, the normal day-to-day of having everyone in the cage and all working, and everyone is so excited about what they do and what they're working on. And I think that is what I will have in my mind when I leave, because that sense of community, you know, it's heartbreakingly painful or heartbreakingly beautiful to leave it, but when I do, I'm going to try to look for that sense of community again. I'm not sure if I'll be able to find it again, but that's okay, because I hope that'll just continue on as I leave and for the next generations, because that sense of drive and community is something that RRPl started with, and I hope that it really never goes away, because other clubs have taken notice of it, other people have taken notice of it, professors, people in the department, and they've all seen it and they all know it, and it's something that's so beautiful that I don't think is really, well, I think it's very hard to find in other places for sure.
Hi, I'm Claudine Smith, and welcome to The Big Show. Today I'm interviewing Jeremy Francoeur from the Rutgers Solar Club. Hi, Jeremy.
Hi, Claudine.
How are you doing today?
I'm good.
Okay. Yeah. How does the Rutgers Solar Club promote sustainability?
So our club's main mission is to build a prototype, not the first prototype, because a lot of other schools have done it, to make a solar-powered car that can go on highways, is safe for the driver, and is completely run by the solar panels on its roof. And there are some companies that were born out of those kinds of clubs in the Netherlands that that started to make commercial ones that where you can even plug it in as it's getting charged by the sun. In my freshman year at Rutgers, I was looking for a club to join just to boost my resume. So it was like between that and the Star Club. And I randomly on a whim joined the Rutgers Solar Car Club and decided like it was a great fit.
And what was it like joining your freshman year? What did you do?
I was nervous and we didn't do much of anything other than like sit around and listen to like someone, like a senior talk to us about like what the race is about. And recently we've like kind of flipped that. Now we, instead of lecturing people, we work fast and loose to like put pencil and paper and like machines together to actually build this product.
Okay. And do you have any goals moving forward?
I want to promote more sustainability living, and maybe solar cars aren't the wave of the future, since it takes a lot of engineering hours to build just one car and also a lot of materials. It might be better to have a big like trains or like solar powered buses like that, and then we could charge them through ports from solar farms.
Yeah. How does working sustainably impact your creation and your project?
It really motivates us to like build the most efficient car. And although this would be our first year having a running car since, do you mind if I go do a little bit of history on the Rutgers Solar?
Yeah, that's fine.
So in around 2016, Stanford donated a lot of supplies to us. Like they had excess and we were starting a new club. And then, so that didn't build much. Nobody really knew how to do anything with all these supplies. So they hobbled it all together and they brought it to a racetrack one summer. And there we learned a lot from all the other teams. And so like in days they were able to like mill out suspension parts and like put it on the car. So then they came back with all that information and started to teach everyone else. So now we're like actually motivated to like build our first Rutgers car that's like all or mostly made in-house. So we just want to see like a running car that's not like the most efficient, but it works. And then we take that and do the same thing next year.
Okay. How far along are you guys in building the car?
So right now we're finalizing our chassis. So that's like all the metal parts inside the vehicle that hold it up together. We're just finalizing a few calculations, then we're going to send it out to get cut. We're going to weld it ourselves. And right now we've got basically all the electronics figured out. So we're just waiting on the final chassis to be built, then the aero body to be put over it. And it'll be ready to run. Hope that it's done early June so that we can race June 24th to July 2nd. So that'll be a track race in Kansas City.
So the purpose of the solar car is to race, basically?
There are two races alternating every year. There's FSGP, the Formula Sun Grand Prix, and then the American Solar Challenge. So one is a track race, which is as many laps as you can around a Formula One track. And then the other is a road race that's from like halfway across the country to the other half, like, and that's on real highways. So yeah, the purpose is really just to like see how much better our car is against other colleges.
How has STEM innovations impacted the design of your car?
We use very high efficient solar cells. So that allows us to fill up our battery pack. Our aero body is gonna be made of fiberglass. So that's very light and helps us limit waste energy. One of our leads, Rosetta Cicero, she designs our aero body to like limit as much drag as we can while fitting as much solar panels on it. So it kind of looks like a ping pong table on wheels.
Ping pong table.
Yeah. And then batteries, of course. Right now we use lithium ion batteries. It's like a 256 like, batteries of this size, like all in a box.
Wow. And how functional is the ping pong table?
Very functional. It's, I think, the solar panel is around 3 to 5 kilowatts. And that's like, you could microwave your burrito with that energy or go across America.
And what was your biggest challenge in, I guess, designing the car in any way?
That's getting the team together, getting more people on the team. So, like I said, COVID hit us pretty hard.
How do the various sections that make up your team deal with focus on sustainability?
So our team is split up. There's the electrical system. There's the mechanical system that does all the brake suspension and the building of the chassis. The aero body and composites system. So that's designing what you see on the outside of the car. There's a cockpit with a bulb on top of the ping pong table. And then everything is like as smooth as you can with the least sharp edges that you can get on it. And then there's telemetry, which is like getting data in and out of the car. And then business, of course, for recruitment and fundraising.
Do you guys have any challenges recruiting or anything?
Yeah, definitely. Since right now it's maybe like two dozen of us, we already have our hands full in completing the car. So recruitment gets like fallen off the wayside, and we never get time to go around and like get people on board other than like Rutgers Get Involved and Rutgers Day. Those are our biggest recruiting events.
And what's it like working in the new student project studio on Bush?
Oh, it's a blast. We're really thankful for the School of Engineering and for their donations, and Bruce and Phyllis Nicholas, whose names are on the building. It really helps us get going and complete this car.
Can you tell us more about the creation of the car and just how this all got started?
Yeah, so like I said, the Stanford and the old members of the 2016 to 2020 team gave us like a really great jumping off point. So they had a chassis with solar panels already on it, and wheels and a suspension, everything that needed to go except no like working system, electronic system inside it. So then we decided, all right, we're gonna have to build something from the ground up. We decided this like September or August. And so now one of our longtime members, Bavish, he said, I think we have an old chassis design somewhere in the files. So let's pull that up. Let's optimize it, make it like pass inspection. And then let's work with that. Meanwhile, me, Ahmed, and Reed and Rohan, we're all electrical engineers and leads. We decide, all right, we're going to take care of the electrical system, and then we'll help anywhere we need. Yeah, and then the rest of the mechanical team is working on brakes and suspension, and that will get milled out, hopefully in the Bruce and Phyllis Nicholas Project Studio. And and then more about the competition. We go there, and then we get like scrutineered. Like some professional engineers come, and like one might even like throw a wrench into the battery box. Yeah, so then we either get a green, a pass, or a no pass, and then we can race or not.
And what was the criteria to get to race in Kansas?
We needed to send in a lot of forms, so like about our car, like a lot of design reports, and from there, they could fail us from that, and like we don't even get to go to Kansas to like get scrutinized. But I think we should get passed on those pretty soon.
And this will be Rutgers Solar first time at this race?
They've been before, but I don't think they didn't pass the scrutiny.
When was the first time, and how many times have you guys raced there?
It was just the one time in 2019, I believe. Okay. 2018, yeah.
And what are your guys' goals for racing in Kansas?
We just want to see a car to run from Rutgers University.
Well, I wish you guys good luck at the Kansas race, and thank you so much for being on the big show. Is there anything else you'd like to say?
I guess I'd like to promote the Rutgers Solar Car Instagram. I think it's RU Solar. And then if anybody wants to learn how to build a car, be more sustainable, or learn more about solar power, then come out to the Bruce and Phyllis Nicholas Project Studio or DM us on Instagram.
Awesome. Well, I hope you guys enjoyed learning about sustainability and the Rutgers Solar Club. That's it for this episode of The Big Show.
Rutgers Scarlet Knights are an icon of Rutgers University. They're really a center point of all athletic events that happen at the university. The Marching Scarlet Knights, we perform at numerous high-value events throughout the semester. As a Scarlet Knight, you can really make really lasting bonds and memories. It's just a great way to make friendships. Whenever we march onto the field, it's awesome hearing the crowd roar. And just, it's amazing to see the thousands of people in the stands. I'm hoping I can see you on the field in the future. It's an amazing family to be a part of, and I would always recommend joining the marching band.
I'm here with the RU Solar team. Guys, what building are we in, by the way?
We're in the Bruce and Phyllis Nicholas Student Project Studio.
Okay, that's long. Yeah. So we're basically on Bush campus at the engineering sector. It is super cool here, guys. My eyes are wide. I don't know what's happening here, but it's super cool. Would you all like to introduce yourself?
I'm Jeremy Francoeur, the battery systems lead of Rutgers Solar Car.
I'm Rosetta Cicero. I'm the aerodynamics and composites lead of Rutgers Solar Car.
And I'm Anthony Scalia. I help with inventory and fielding questions from the team.
But for the people that don't know, what is the RU Solar team and what do y'all do?
So we're trying to create a solar powered car to race against other colleges and even companies. There's two races, one on a track and one halfway across America.
So y'all start from one point and then you go across halfway across America in your solar car.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And was this one of them? What is this about?
Yeah, so this was, most of it was donated to us from Stanford 4 or 5 years ago. And we're trying to build our own from a Rutgers branded one from scratch. Not many of the current members had any manufacturing experience with this one. So it'd be nice if we could race a new one.
And that new one y'all are building right now.
Yeah.
It started. Walk me through it. How's this process like? How did it start? And what's the progress on it right now?
So first we usually start with a chassis. So that's gonna be welded out of steel tubes. And then from there, Rosetta designed an aero body that covers it. If you wanna go into that.
I've been working on it since the beginning of last semester, actually. Started off kind of rough, actually. This one's like one of the first iterations right here. Doesn't look too great, especially compared to the newest one, which is this right here, which is actually what we're going to be manufacturing. I also 3D printed it as a model for like being able to see it better.
And does the actual vehicle itself need a license or a permit?
Yeah.
It needs to be registered as a motorcycle, effectively.
Not to plug myself here, but I do have a driver's license. I can drive. Yeah. Are y'all gonna put me as a driver, as a candidate for a driver for one of these in June?
Do you, yeah, we'll measure your dimensions and make sure you have a spot in there.
Yeah. Got it. Mm-hmm. So it starts out as something on this computer. Some 3D models are printed, small 3D models. And then how do y'all make it the actual thing? Where do y'all go?
Yep. So we're gonna have a company cut all the tubes, the steel tubes we need, then we're gonna weld it ourselves. And from there, when that's done, we're gonna attach the canopy and aerobody. And then all the electronics, we're building the systems right in this room.
This space is so unique. What makes the RU Solar Team Club different from the other clubs?
Mm-hmm. Our car, every year we do a 20. Every year that we'll have a car, we'll be doing a 24-hour race over the span of 3 days. So we'll have to like run 8 hours straight each day. Mm-hmm. And then every second year, we'll also have the cross-country race, which is 1,500 plus miles on like regular roads to deal with as well.
We have the technology to build a lot of solar cars. It's just we don't really have the manpower or the funds to do it.
No. And then the battery that powers it, solar. What is solar? What powers it? And why is it so important to have?
So as an alternative to using gasoline-powered cars, we could use solar-powered cars or even electric vehicles that we can charge from the grid that could possibly be solar-powered. And so all that energy gets stored into the battery pack.
The most important part of the race is basically starting off with a fully charged battery, yeah, and then using the sun to basically top you off every single day.
Right now we're trying to charge this battery pack. That would be using this standard electric vehicle charger that we can plug in, and also we can turn on our battery management system.
So you start from scratch?
From scratch with a lot of that the previous team bought for us.
The actual thing that goes into the actual car, what is that? Just the orange batteries, and then this is something to charge it?
Yeah, it's just the batteries, this BMS, battery management system, and some contactors that I could show you. So if I plug in this last connection, then the whole battery pack should be connected. And yeah, so now it's dangerous.
Yeah.
Do not step in that box.
I'm learning something here. Jeremy, I'm learning something.
Good.
I think I'm on my way to become an engineer.
I think so too. You're learning pretty fast.
And this listens to Nirvana?
It does, yes.
I like this one automatically.
Good.
I like this one automatically. Thank you so much, Jeremy.
Yeah, no problem.
Let me show you what Rosetta's doing in the composite room.
I bet.
Hey, Rosetta, what are you doing?
Well, I'm glad you asked. We're currently working on expanding the primer layer on the mold.
I mean, the final product with the fiberglass. How heavy would that be?
It'll be actually quite light. If you go over here to the, this is actually the old hand for our hand.
Yeah.
So this, like, it's going to be similar to the final part that we made. I can just lift this up.
Oh!
Yeah. So it's much lighter than like the mold would be. And like if you were to try and make this out of like a non-composite material, it'd also be much heavier.
Having this thing to help with how it's arranging here is great help for me. We're doing amazing on this.
Alex, Anthony, do your arms hurt right now?
Well, it's for a good cause.
Yeah.
So imagine drivers right here.
Might be neat. The driver
facing forward. Certainly could. Now flip it around. Now imagine this mold is the top side of the vehicle. So these two partitions will be attached to the sides of the vehicle. This would be the upper half. And if you were sitting right here and you were looking this way, you'd be driving our solar car.
And the roll cage is there to protect, right?
Absolutely.
Exactly.
Make sure I come home, because I'm going to be here. Can I actually see the roll cage? Can I like touch it?
Oh yeah. This is just like a wood mock-up. So like, it's kind of flimsy compared to like what the actual roll cage would be.
So this is what you mean.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Hey, are you solar? We're winning the race. I can kind of imagine myself. Yay. Go, are you solar? Thank you so much, Jeremy. Thank you so much, Anthony. Thank you so much, Alex. Thank you so much, Rosetta. I had a great time. Hopefully, I'm going to drive one of these things soon. Follow the LinkedIn. Follow the Instagram, the LinkedIn first, of course. And I'll see y'all in the next episode. Thank you. Are you solar? The Big Show.